That is a question that we get asked a lot. And honestly, I wish I could give you a straight answer, but it really depends on what you're shooting and how slow you want that to look on screen. There are some obvious uses for a Phantom. Sometimes things are just a bit too quick to properly see with the naked eye. If you were to take a match, for example, and light it, you know, you would see the match being lit. But if you would look at that on a Phantom, you'd see all the kind of little hidden details of it sparking up and glowing, you know, the hidden magic in that. But it's not just the obvious. Sometimes you just want to add some dramatic effect or a bit of grandeur or poetry to a shot, and that's also where a Phantom can come in and help. Yeah, absolutely. All the latest digital cinema 4K cameras will do some sort of slow-mo. And if you have the high-speed license, an ARRI LF will do 90 frames per second, the Mini LF will do 60, and the Sony Venice will do 110 frames per second, which may be perfectly acceptable for what you're trying to do. But bearing in mind that a Phantom will be considerably slower than that. So just to show you an example, this is in real time. This is at 110 frames per second. And the top of this will be at 1,000 frames per second. So, just recently, Red released the 8K Red Raptor. And this can actually do 240 frames per second, which is faster than, you know, the ARRI or the Venice. But remember, the Phantom can do 1,000 frames per second at 4K, which is still four times slower. Here are some shots at different frame rates, which will hopefully help you choose the right camera system for your shoot. So sometimes even 1,000 frames is not quite enough. And with the Phantom 4K, we have the option of windowing the sensor, which can get us pretty close to 2,000 frames per second, which is a bit of a sweet spot for some fluids. So there are a couple of different Phantom 4K options, but this particular one, the VEO 4K, shouldn't really cost you any more than hiring a full-size ARRI LF. The main additional cost, if not shooting daylight exteriors, is lighting. And we have a rule of thumb that we like to use if nothing really changes, like your lighting position, your stop, or your shutter angle. And that is, for every doubling of frame rate, you double the amount of light needed. But having said that, the insert shot that you saw earlier of a coin being flipped at 1,000 frames per second was actually shot with this exact same LED lighting setup, and we just brought the lights in a little bit closer. Mechanically, this camera works like any other digital cinema camera you've used. It uses the same bridge plates, batteries, lenses, viewfinder, monitor, even the same sort of lens mounts, PL and LPL. And it will also work on grip that you're familiar with, like a crane or a jib, or even a gimbal. Where this camera differs from other 4K cinema cameras, in order to record 1,000 plus frames per second, it can't record directly to removable media. So instead, it has dedicated, super fast internal memory. So, for example, the internal memory on this camera will give you about 5.5 seconds at 4K of event capture time. That same 5.5 seconds when played back at 4K will give you about 4 minutes of slow motion. Your only challenge is lining up those 5.5 seconds of capture time at 4K with your action. Luckily, there are multiple tools to help you with this process. And one of them is to choose a trigger point. Now, because the camera is constantly recording to this internal memory, you can set the trigger point to be at the beginning of the memory, anywhere in the middle, or at the end, and that helps you line up the recording to whatever's happening in your event. If you are shooting, say, an unpredictable event, then it's often easier to put a trigger point at the end of the internal memory, and that will allow you to save 5.5 seconds into the past. And to make that even easier, there are multiple ways to physically trigger the camera. Once you're happy that you've got your shot, the next thing to do is to download that shot. And you have the option of going to removable media. So in the case of the VEO, it's compact flash. And with the Flex, it's a Cinemag. But our favorite method is to go directly to a laptop over a super fast 10 gig Ethernet connection. And for example, that shot you saw earlier of the coin being flipped at 1,000 frames actually took us about 15 seconds to download. If you wanted to download the full 4 minutes of 4K uncompressed RAW over the 10 gig Ethernet, it would take up to about 2 minutes to do that. But typically it takes a lot less to save the shot because you have the ability to quickly set in and out points, so you only save the bit you really want. We would often recommend working with the Phantom Cine RAW files in a similar way that you would work with Red RAW, ARRI RAW, or Sony RAW. But if you prefer working with 4K QuickTimes or MXFs, a laptop like this one with the free version of DaVinci Resolve Lite will actually transcode those Cine RAW files in double time or faster. Outside of the admittedly impressive looking demo footage from companies like Nvidia, post-processed slo-mo doesn't often work because it kind of relies on things like a simple object and a simple background and a non-moving camera. And outside of these specifics, it often just falls apart and will result in artifacts, and the quality just won't be as good as doing it for real. If you insist on doing it in post, test your workflow with realistic examples. And our recommendation is to shoot as high a frame rate as possible so that your software is having to invent less information. Another question that we get asked is, can I shoot at normal frame rates, say 25 frames per second, on a Phantom 4K? And the answer is yes, we're shooting on a Phantom right now. And I'm about to trigger to save that recording. Hopefully this introduction video has been helpful for you in working out if you need a Phantom 4K for your production. If you have any questions, then please get in contact. Details are below.